Germ theory versus cellular theory. Which one was right? Dr. Maya Shetreat-Klein answered at the Functional Forum.
Okay, so where did we get this idea of avoid, avoid, avoid? So our good friend Louis Pasteur, back in the day, basically said, okay, well, diseases are caused by these microscopic, invisible to us microorganisms, and they invade us, and they basically grow out of control and reproduce and kill us. Right? I mean, that's the germ theory. Okay? And it's not like totally off. I mean, we do know that that is an element of what happens. It's sort of that story of the elephant, right? Like the blind man and the elephant, and we're all touching, right? So there is that process that does happen sometimes. But there was another school of thought at the same time, Claude Bernard and others, who had this other idea of the cellular theory. And we skipped there. Okay. So most microbial diseases are caused by organisms present in the body of a normal individual, and they become the cause of disease when a disturbance arises which upsets the equilibrium of the body. Okay. So I think of the germ theory as kind of a sitting duck theory, right? Like we're just sitting there, and basically anything could come your way and attack you and kill you, and there's nothing you could do about it. The cellular theory I think of as the terrain theory. Okay. And the terrain theory is, who is the person who is the host of the organism, and what's happening in that relationship? And the cellular theory kind of gives you an idea that maybe you actually could do something about what's happening in the body. I'm like not getting this so right. Okay. So our bodies actually crave complexity, and our immune systems are actually like not like these warriors that we thought, but kind of more meet and greet. Meet and greet, you know, likes to meet lots of different organisms all the time, and learning and kind of developing that way. So I actually think this magic bullet model, like antibiotics, right, or vaccines, or any of these things are really outdated, because really biodiversity is what we're learning is the new magic bullet, if there were one. So our paradigm is starting to change. We're using probiotics. We're using things like Saccharomyces boulardii, yeast. Yeast is helping, you know, to get rid of things like C. diff, the microbiome and oncolytic viruses, which I'm going to talk about, and things like soil-based organisms and fecal transplants. Can you imagine 15, 20 years ago talking about infusing feces into people? I mean, you know. But here it is, and it has good data. So, we know that diverse microbes actually prevent atopic disease. And, you know, so there's a study that we all know about, the hygiene hypothesis, right? And there's this study that basically said kids on farms are less likely to have atopy, asthma, and so on. So we thought, okay, well, that's probably because in urban areas there's just not so much microbes, right? So then that's probably what it is. But someone actually said, well, let's actually examine that. So they did, and it turned out, no, there were the same number of microbes, more or less. The difference was the diversity. So on a farm, there were many, 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 many more organisms, whereas urban, many fewer, a very narrow array. And that actually is what they felt made the difference. So now we're also starting to understand how, you know, atopic disease and asthma and all these kind of allergic and autoimmune responses are really coming, being driven by the gut and being driven by flora. And although we're talking about the gut microbiome, I want to just kind of remind everybody that we have a lot of microbiomes in our body. I think the skin microbiome is something we ignore a lot, and I think, you know, that's probably related to vitamin D issues, how we absorb vitamin D, and there's a lot that could be said about our total microbiome. Even the placenta has a microbiome, which we used to think was sterile. So there's a lot of microbiomes to think about, but we are all into the gut right now, so that's where we'll go. And you know, we're learning basically again that like babies with certain kinds of flora and more narrow flora are more likely to develop asthma later.
Thanks so much for watching, and for more great clips like this, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. I've created a special free video just for you. It's called The 5 Steps to Becoming a Leader in Your Wellness Community, and it'll give you some of the starting points on how to position yourself as the leader in your zip code of your health community. All you have to do is click on the link below.